Nih.
Ya, selamat pagi.
Admin.justmasak. My name is Muhammad Asyif. Pengajar, tutor, dan juga lektor untuk adik-adik mahasiswa di program studi kehutanan Universitas Brawijaya. Selamat pagi semua untuk adik-adik mahasiswa. Salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, Salam Kebajikan. Baik, pada pagi ini kita akan melanjutkan untuk kuliah tamu dari Prof. Azani, yang pada kali ini kita akan membahas yang tidak kalah menarik dari kemarin. Ya, tentunya kalau misalkan kemarin kita membahas mengenai sistem silvikultur, kemudian kalau untuk di pada pertemuan kali ini kita akan membahas mengenai bagaimana pengelolaan mangrove dan juga swamp forest atau gambut di Malaysia. Mungkin bisa langsung saja dipersilakan untuk Prof. Azani. Prof. Azani,
terima kasih.
Time yours.
Okay, thank you. Terima kasih. So pagi ini sebenarnya kan actually for today we would like to discuss about a different topic because of the I got a problem with my computer last night. Something wrong with my computer, have been attacked by the virus, so all of my data in my laptop I cannot retrieve. So I need to change the topic. So today I will give you to discuss with you is about the silviculture of the mangrove forest that we have in Malaysia. So I share screen. Before that, maybe I need to switch off my camera because it's my line is not good today. It's cloudy. Okay, so okay, last 2 days ago, we have discussed about the silviculture system for the lowland and also the hill deep trochaic forest. It's back 1901. We start in lowland deep trochaic forest in Malaysia almost how many 120 years ago. So we have the few silviculture system that we apply on the lowland deep trochaic forest through MRIS, and then we go to MUS before we end up with the SMS. So just for review, right? Last time we talked about the simple silviculture treatment. It's very simple. For me, I said it's simple because you start with the vegetation inventory, pre-F inventory, and then you do the logging, and then come back again to the forest, do the inventory. So that means you have a data before logging and also after logging. So by having data analysis, you know what you have after logging. For example, you know what is the residue stand and everything, and also by having the inventory, you also know what is the medium cutting limit, because lowland and also the hill deep trochaic forest, we apply it in uneven age, in uneven age forest. So for the sustainability, you cannot cut down all, and we cannot apply the clear cutting, because we have lots of species there. Okay, so that's why we have modification of MUS. We have the selective management system. Selective, when you do the selective, that means you just select a few species, a few tree with a certain diameter to cut down. That means you can get the next rotation within another 20 to 30 years. So that is a modification of MUS to SMS. If MUS, they just cut any tree bigger than 45. So that means they will cut lots of big tree and leave it very small amount of small tree. Eh? So today we're going to discuss about the mango forest. Maybe next time I will discuss about peat swamp forest, because I don't think we can have mango forest and peat swamp forest in one lecture, because it takes time. Yeah, for me, I give a class here also. Peat swamp forest is 2 hours, mangrove forest is 2 hours. So for today, I give you the mangrove forest. Okay, so in Malaysia, we have one mangrove forest in northern part of Peninsula Malaysia, in Perak. We call it Matang. Matang in English is Mecher, but this is the place name Matang. Matang is not related to the Mecher mangrove forest. Matang is a place name. Okay, so today I'm going to explain the silviculture of Matang mangrove. Why is Matang mangrove forest? Matang mangrove forest is one of the oldest mangrove forests that have been applied the silviculture management system, which mostly we cut the mangrove in Matang forest for charcoal production. Charcoal production. Until now, we're still producing lots of charcoal, export to mostly to Japan, China, Taiwan, and also Korea. They use our charcoal. It's not for firewood. Actually, they use in something related to cosmetic, something also related to the filtration system. For example, you have the water filter at your house. If you bought it from Korea, for example, the brand of Conway, for example, they use the charcoal come from Malaysia. Charcoal come from the mangrove forest, Malaysia. Okay, so I just go, what is mangrove? I think all of you know what is mangrove. Mangrove is a woody plant that grow at the interface between land and sea. So I think you are familiar with this kind of profile. This kind of profile for mangrove. So we have Sonaratia and also Abyssinia in the sea. Okay, go back into the reservoir, go more inland area, you can have Brugeria. So actually, mangrove have a few zonation. I think you know about this. Maybe some of you already study or learn about the mangrove ecology. So, okay. So where is the production forest in mangrove forest? Which one is more productive? We have three zones. We have Sonaratia Abyssinia, we have Rhizophora, and we have Brugeria zone. So we have three. So which one is productive forest for mango? Okay, the productive forest that we harvest, the tree that we harvest is come from mostly from the zone of Rhizophora, in the middle, Rhizophora. Okay, so however, this mangrove vegetation comprised of far wider variety, and the ecosystem cover a much larger than commonly understood. Simply put, mangroves are found in the environment between land and sea, between land and the sea, the last, like I have mentioned to you. And before that, in Malaysia, mangroves are known as hutan bakau, or sometimes we call hutan paya laut. Hutan paya laut, and the former trend to be used to refer to species of in this ecosystem, which is Rhizophora apiculata, and another one is Rhizophora mucronata. So both Rhizophora we harvest it for charcoal production and also for a small pool. Okay, so this is to show you the Sonaratia species, which is advancing into the sea. So in terms of density, it's not so much dense. It's scattered in the open sea. And I would like to talk about the amount of one of the mangrove forests that we have in Malaysia. Malaysia, that mean include the Sabah and Sarawak. Okay, totally we have around 500,000 hectares. In Peninsular Malaysia is about 1.7% of the total land area of Malaysia. Very small, less than 2%. 1.7%. So this is the breakdown for 2004. Actually, not so much different. Because we do the planting, the planting of the mangrove after we cut down, but not so much increase in terms of acres. So Sabah got lots of mangrove forest. They got about 0.34 million hectares. Sarawak, 0.3 million hectares. And Peninsular Malaysia is only 0.1 million hectares. And mostly in Perak, we have lots of in Perak, 43,500 hectares. Johor, the southern part of Peninsular, got 20,000. And in Selangor alone, actually, in Selangor also, we have lots of mangrove forest, almost 20,000 hectares. You know that Selangor is near to the capital of Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur. So Selangor, we can say, very busy. And in terms of, for your information, Selangor has stopped logging for more than 10 years. Not logging in mangrove forest, but the whole forest in Selangor have been stopped for more than 10 years ago. Yeah, we didn't do any logging in Selangor. So our forest right now, we do the conservation, we do the planting, replanting back in Selangor. And then we upgrade all the forest in Selangor more towards to conservation and also for tourism, ecotourism. For example, now we have lots of trail, go to the mountain in Selangor. Okay, so we go to the Matang Forest. So we go to the Matang Forest. Before that, some of the amount, this is for in Perak, 43,502, but in Matang alone is already 40,000. So that means Matang is very big area, 40,000 compared the whole Perak is 45. So that means almost 40,000. So it's managed in 1902. It's very long time ago. Almost same like that we have done to our lowland beautiful cut forest. Also start in 1901. And the mangrove forest is start managed by 1902. And we have the management plan. We have the management plan for the mangrove forest. And it's the first management plan is start in 1950. Quite late. We use the forest 1902, but not so intensive. But in night after the World War II, so the mangrove have been used mostly for using for the charcoal and also for the small pool for the construction. So starting 1950, so we have our first 10-year management plan. Why we need a management plan? Because management plan, by having the management plan, we can plan how much we can cut per year, the coupe, how much we need to cut per year. Then we also can decide how big area that we can plant every year. So in early 1950, the cutting is very simple. Just they start with inventory first. Before logging, they have inventory, but not precise. They just go, for example, if they want to cut 100 hectares, for example, they just go for 50 meters inside the forest. And if they found enough big tree, they go for clear cutting. But after that, we have a more better management plan. Okay, so the main species that I said before is a Rhizophora apiculata and also Mucronata. This has been harvested. Meanwhile, the Lenggada, Bulgaria, two cut type of Bulgaria, we didn't cut. Eh? We didn't cut, we just cut the rhizophora, apiculata and mucronata. So there is the management history. The need for management immediately realized following the effort of gazettement. So gazettement of the island reserve began in 1902. At that time, it been done by the British. His name is Wells, Mr. Wells, in 1904. So what is the best of having mangrove management plan? Actually, it's a faithful painstaking vision by this successor, and also the main important by having this is contribute to the success of the mangrove Mata mangrove management system. And then since then, it's been revised every year. Yeah, every year been revised, and this is the history. Start 19. Before that, revision have been done a few times. Yeah. Then we have 1950, our first management plan. Our first management plan has really been prepared by the British, but after 20 years, after, or we can say after two cycles done by the British, so Malaysian started 1970, Muhammad Darus. Muhammad Darus, this is our forester. Our forester start the first local, we can say local people to do the management plan. And until now, we have still every year, we still using the 10 years revision update, but not so much actually, not so much updated because the system, the silviculture system almost same. Almost same. I can show you the picture. It start 1902 until now, not so much difference in terms of silviculture system. Harvesting, the method of harvesting, the machine that been used also almost, because we are still using the manual, manual using edge. And also right now they use the chainsaw. Okay, so the management objective, mostly the mangrove forest are production of fuel wood, in terms of charcoal, and then the production of pools. Pools is more the construction, for the construction. And also we do this management for the conservation and protection. You know that in our forest, in our mangrove forest, we have lots of wildlife there. In Sarawak or in Sabah, we have proboscis monkey. Proboscis monkey stay in mangrove forest. Not in Peninsula Malaysia. In Peninsula Malaysia, we don't have a proboscis monkey. We have an ordinary monkey. And then conservation in terms of the marine animals, we have lots of kind of fish. So it's very important to manage the mangrove forest for the conservation. And then we do the recreation and ecotourism. Been used, mangrove have been used for recreation and also the ecotourism. The education and research development. Education mostly not only for university level, but also for the school, for school children. In Malaysia, we have a special program for the school children. They can visit our mangrove center in Malaysia, in Peninsula Malaysia. We have few mangrove center in few state alone. For example, in Pahang, we have in Terengganu, we have Perak, Aunty, Johor, and also in Selangor. So each education center that related to the mangrove, the student or any people or any visitor go there, they can learn about the mangrove ecology system, and also they can do planting. They can feel how to plant lots of mud. It's very, very fun actually. Okay, the management zoning. We have management zoning for our mangrove in Matang Forest. Because we do for production of charcoal, so we need to have the management plan according to the zone. So we divide into four. One is the productive zone, productive zone, that means we can do some cutting. Restrictive productive zone. This is a restrictive productive zone. And then we have unproductive. And then last is the protective zone. So let's see what is the productive zone. So this productive zone is a productive forest comprising rhizophora. Remember, we have two kind of rhizophora, apiculata and mucronata. And also we have together with Bulgaria parviflora forest, and also the mixed Bulgaria cylindrica forest. So where is located? It's located here. Yeah, it's located somewhere here. So this is the productive zone. So productive zone, what do you mean with productive zone? You do the harvesting here. You can do the harvesting here. So next is the restrictive productive zone. Or we can say restrictive productive forest. A new inclusion which is necessary to take into consideration the important place on the conservation and maintenance of fragile and sensitive ecosystem within the mangrove forest. The forest under this category, transitional new forest, seaward growth forest, and the dry land transitional forest. So where is it? Where is it? So it is the blue color. This is the restrictive forest. So that means it's located here, between this is Abyssinia, this is Abyssinia, is a protective forest. So we have the restrictive forest, and at the back, the green one is the productive forest. Productive forest, that means you can do logging here. So this one, we didn't do logging. And the darker green color, this is a place that we said as a restrictive productive zone. We didn't do logging in this at here. So this is actually our stock. The vegetation here, we can set lots of mother tree. And we collect all the seedlings mostly from here to be planted in the green zone at the back. Okay. And then we have unproductive zone. Unproductive zone is this one, the red color, not so much. The unproductive zone mostly bun and bun reserve. Bun is located inside the main forest. They have something like the beting pasir we call. And then area cut off. And then fishing village. We have fishing village. Many nelayan we have here, fishermen. They stay here, so their fishing village, we have to do some reservation. Disturbed forest complex, pool landing site. Pool landing site is when you do harvesting from this kind of forest, productive forest, you will bring all the wood, all the trees nearby to the village. So at that village, we put a few places. Not all village going to have the pool landing site. Maybe just we can select only few site located in the village. Mostly the fishermen village. Then tidal gate and buffer reserve. This is the unproductive zone. Okay, so the protective zone, this is the fragile and environmentally important accreting Abyssinia forest. So Abyssinia forest, that means will be onward inside the sea. So this is the yellow color. So this is the yellow color, Abyssinia forest. And also the dry land forest, Abyssinia on the sea. And our dry land forest is at the back of the productive forest. So we have at the back. So this kind of dryland forest mostly is a virgin jungle forest, old growth forest, and also reserve forest, ecotourism forest, stock lake buffer reserve, and also archaeological buffer reserve. But only Abyssinia is located outside of the more to inward to the sea. Other than that, the dry land. Dry land, this is the dry land. Virgin jungle or growth habitat. Okay. So this is the zoning. We have four zoning by having the mangrove management plan. So we divide into four. This is only four matang. Not the same management plan can be applied to other mangrove forests in Peninsular Malaysia. We have only four matang. For other state, they have their own management plan, but almost same. They also have the management zone, but some of the management zone maybe sometimes they don't have the productive forest. They have the management zone, maybe they only have three zone, for example. They don't have for the productive forest. Maybe in Selangor, we stop already the productive forest. So that means we can say we have three zone, three management zone in mangrove forest in Selangor. But in Perak, we still have four management zone. So, okay. This is matang, and then this is zoning according to the name. The name of the village, Kuala Sepetang. This is Kuala Sepetang, the village, a fisherman village. We have two Kuala Sepetang. One is north, or another one is south. We have Kuala Terong Range, another fisherman village. And then last, we have Sungai Krang. So each village, actually, they have their own economic background. For example, Kuala Sepetang, both, Kuala Sepetang, north and south, they have charcoal production industry there. Compare with Kuala Terong, they have more landing only. The landing, pool landing. And Sungai Kerang is more to urban area. Not so urban area, but it's more better in terms of the village condition is more better. So our productive, this is again, protective, unproductive, this is productive forest, and this is the restricted productive forest. Okay, the management plan objective is to produce high quality of bakau timber being used for charcoal and also pool. That's all. We just use charcoal and pool. How many percent for charcoal? How many percent for pool? Right now is 90% for charcoal, only 10% used for pool. Before, maybe we can say 50 years ago, we use more for pool. Pool can go for, I think, 70% pool and 30% charcoal. At that time, 50 years ago, charcoal been used locally. It's not export. But right now, mostly charcoal produced in Malaysia have been export to overseas. We are still using charcoal, but not from mangrove forest. We have a new source of wood to make the charcoal because charcoal from bakau or mangrove forest is very high quality and will be better to sell outside of Malaysia because of the price. So we use in Malaysia that charcoal come from, you know, the residual from the thinning of the in our SMS, for example, in our lowland deep tokak forest. So the residual we can produce charcoal. It's not a good charcoal, not a good quality charcoal. You know that we didn't use so much charcoal for firewood. We didn't for, but we use charcoal mostly for do some filtration, water filtration, pharmaceutical also using charcoal. Okay, then the management system. Another one is about the regeneration. So for charcoal, for bakau, we do the clear cutting. We do the clear cutting. I explained to you why, because we only have two species. Two species being used for our mangrove plantation. This is a Rhizophora apiculata and Mucronata. So these two species have the same growth, almost the same growth performance. The requirement of the everything is almost same, so we can use both species. So which one is good for charcoal? Which one is good for pool? Almost good quality. Both of them almost good quality. Okay. And then we do the replanting. Okay, we go to this emphasis on Rhizophora mucronata and also this mucronata. So if using these two species to produce charcoal, the rotation is take about 30 years. It take about 30 years. The tree can grow until 40 years old, but at the matured one is good to harvest at the age of 30 years. So current system adopt a rotation period of 30. This is influenced by the site productivity, the fertility of the site, the ecological consideration, the flood, everything. Dominant forest type. Mostly our forest dominated by these two species, Rhizophora. Competency and availability of contractor. This is a little bit about the contractor. Sometimes we have our experience before. We choose the contractor and we don't know their experience because of lack of experience to do work in the mangrove forest. Mangrove forest is quite dangerous actually because it's always flooded and slippery. Slippery. And also lots of snake over there. Some of the contractor, they don't have experience to handle the chainsaw, because to handle the chainsaw in the dry land area compared to the mangrove forest is quite different. In mangrove, you know that we got with the water, then you cannot move so much, slow moving from one place to one place, for example, so it's very dangerous for the contractor that have lack of experience. Market, okay, market preference. This is what we do in Malaysia. The government help our planter to get the market, mostly from Japan, Taiwan. Right now, it's Taiwan import lots of our charcoal. Taiwan, Korea, they already. I think the first called Taiwan, and then second is Japan. Before, Japan is number one, but now it's Taiwan. Okay, silviculture advancement, expected forest yield, how much cubic meter we can have for one coop, and the mean diameter of final crop trees. Mean diameter of final crop tree almost the same. After this, we are going to discuss about what is the minimum diameter cutting limit for the mangrove forest. So the management system, again, this is to show to you the cutting rotation, 30 years. We can start with planting. This is the planting at year of two. This is already planted. This is already planted. The clear cutting already planted. At the age of 15 years old, we do the first thinning. Then we do the first thinning. And then at the age of 20 years, we do another thinning. The first thinning in year 15 is 1.2 meter between the three. At the age of 20, we do the 1.8 diameter, 1.8 radius, meter radius. And at the age of 30, we do the final felling. So that means we only have two thinning at the age of 15 and 20. And then last, at 30 years old, we do the final felling. I think it's familiar. Is it almost same with Indonesian mangrove forest system? Okay. So yield regulation, the one that I told you. The objective of yield regulation is to ensure a constant supply of green wood. Green wood is a raw material for the local charcoal manufacturing industry. Okay, before 25 years ago, we have more than 100 kin, charcoal kin. Charcoal kin is dapur arang, dipanggil dapur, tempat memproseskan arang, dapur kin, more than 100. But right now, we only have around 20 charcoal kin. Why from 100 become 25. Why? Because of each kin now they have more better system to produce charcoal. Okay? More better system, that means they can make more kin. At one area, they have more than last time, one management, they have only 10 kin, but right now they can go until 20 kin in one place. So that means if 20 kin one place, you have 25 management, 25 contractors. So that means you can have more 200 something. Eh? Okay, regulation through the application of area and volume. Okay, so some the contractor can get the charcoal manufacturer. Sorry, the charcoal manufacturer. They are bidding to get the best wood and also the highest volume. Eh? So they need to get it from our foreign department with a good price. Eh? So under this method, potential area are classified into three productive classes. So we have excellent forest, good forest, and a poor forest. If a good forest, they can produce until 190 tons per hectare. Eh? 190 tons per hectare. And more and less than 10% consisting Bulgaria. Okay, so we plant Rhizophora, Macronata, and Apiculata. But when we do harvesting, we also cut Bulgaria. So where this Bulgaria come? Okay, so this Bulgaria come naturally. Naturally, we didn't plant it. We didn't plant it. It's naturally we plant. Only two species. Okay, we plant only two species. We didn't plant Bulgaria. Because why we didn't plant Bulgaria? Because our aim is to get more Rhizophora. Okay, Rhizophora we can use to produce a good quality of charcoal. Meanwhile, Bulgaria, you can produce charcoal, but the charcoal is not a good quality. But when you do the planting, only Rhizophora, after 30 years, right, within the 30 years, Bulgaria come naturally. So we didn't cut down, we managed that one. Eh? Okay, for the good forest is 189, and then they have less than 30%. Meanwhile, the poor one, okay, the poor forest, 140 ton, but mostly 30%, more than 30% is come from this Bulgaria cylindrica. So that means compare with excellent and excellent good and poor forest, we can understand that. If excellent, that means all more Rhizophora that you plant is survive. Compare with poor forest, you plant Rhizophora and then we can say lots of Rhizophora die. So when this die, we do replanting and then still die. So it's come this Bulgaria easily and naturally into our planted forest. So that's why the poor forest, that mean poor forest happen because of our Rhizophora that we plant already die, yeah, maybe 30%, 40% die, and then been replaced by this Bulgaria cylindrica. Cinderella, Bulgaria, we didn't plant because of low quality. So advantages, only economically productive area are located to charcoal contractor and thus minimizing the need for replacement of area. Okay, so that means that same area, if you cut down for charcoal, so that you plant back also for charcoal production. And we didn't replace the area for different use. Eh? So allow for simplicity of control. To control it is very simple one. Eh? Okay, provided element of security to contractor, assure the contractor that area provided to them shall yield a minimum volume of green wood for charcoal, consisting of a high percentage of economic species. Economic species is referred to Rhizophora, two Rhizophora species. Okay. Our yield estimation carried out periodically truth circular plot method or spot method, 4% inventory intensity. Okay, so that means only 4% inventory. Compare last time, last 2 days ago, for inventory, the lowland and also hill deep trunk forest, we do the 10% inventory. But for the mangrove, we just do 4%. Eh? Compare with mangrove, with 4%, compare with lowland is 10%. Eh? So our plot is circular plot method or spot method. We didn't have a plot like that we apply in lowland. Eh? Lowland forest, we have few the peta utama, peta everything, is it? Eh? So this is a different method because our area for one contractor is not as big as the lowland or deep trunk forest. Eh? Okay, the 1 hectare, they can produce at least 179 tons. Eh? This is for the data within 10 years, eh? 2000 until 2009. This is the yield estimation. Okay, so silviculture is objective to produce a fully stocked forest of the desired species. The desired is, remember, we talk about the reservoir eh, for the next rotation. Our rotation is 30 years. Eh. Based on ecological approach, whereby the silviculture operation are refined or modified to suit the individual forest type, within the prescribed silviculture system of each management zone. Remember, we have 4 management zones, but for have a productive forest, we have the silviculture system eh, being applied. How about other zone? Are we apply also the silviculture system? No, eh? We didn't apply any silviculture system to other zone. Eh? We didn't do thinning, we didn't do clear cutting in other zone. Productive only applied with the silviculture treatment. So we go to the operation, okay? Before that, before we do the felling, 1 year before felling, right? 1 year before felling, we go to our mangrove forest to do our survey. What kind of survey we do? It's very simple. We want to know the size of the standing tree, reservoir, how much percentage of reservoir compared with Bulgaria, because we want to put it, is it a good forest, poor forest, eh? So that is important. Eh? This is 1 year before. Eh? And also, 1 year before logging, we also decide which channel are the best way to go eh, to that harvesting area, okay? So on N is harvesting. All three are felled, that means clear cutting, to produce charcoal similar to clear felling activity. A 3 to 10 meter buffer zone of all three along the river. Eh, along the river, we have a buffer zone, 3 to 10 meter are retained to prevent or reduce erosion, as well as for seed propagation. So that means some of the mother tree will be reserved in this buffer zone. Eh? So we can have the seed over from our buffer zone. Okay? Before leaving the fair area, the charcoal contractors have to gather all non-commercial species. Eh? So that means the contractor, eh, the charcoal contractor, before leave the area, they already cut down. Eh, they already do the clear cutting, take all the reservoir and also Bulgaria. And then after they take out, they need to gather all the commercial, all non-commercial species. Eh, all non-commercial species. Eh. 1 year after final felling is the determination of determination of area for replanting activity. So that means after you do the harvesting, 1 year of harvesting, we are prepare the area for planting. Yeah? So right at that time, we need to take out the invading fern. Yeah? Invading fern, we have lots of kind of fern will be appeared after the clear cutting. Okay. So this has been done manually. And we don't have machine. We didn't have big machine to bring to into our mangrove forest. That mean you just use parang, eh? Only. And then 2 years after logging, a survey to determine and mapping the extent and location of subcoupes requiring planting and refilling. A subcoupe with less than 90% natural regeneration will be subjected to enrichment planting of Rhizophora mucronata with a distance of 1.2 by 1.2. meanwhile for mucronata is 1.8 by 1.8. so that mean before you do planting, actually we wait for 2 years. After 2 years of planting, we go back and we do the some inventory to get the idea if our area already have the natural regeneration. If less than 90%, we be need to do the enrichment planting. Mostly we do planting actually. Mostly we cannot get more than 90% recovered naturally. It's quite difficult right now. One, because of the seed production. Seed production not enough already. The remaining tree within the buffer zone not enough to produce seed naturally for the area. Okay, 3 years. Okay, 3 years after logging, we have the first survival enumeration and enrichment planting if survival of planted seedling is less than 75%. The tree that you planted, the mangrove tree that you planted, after 3 years, you go back and then do the survey. If less than 75, so you replanting. You do the replanting. Okay, after that, okay, within 1 until 3 years, you just do planting, okay? Survey and planting. At the age of 15, after the harvest, we do the first thinning. We're using a stick, 1.2 stick, and this is to know what is the distance between the tree and another tree. Is there any tree within 1.2 meter? So that tree will be eliminated. And then we have the second thinning at the age of 20, using only 1.8 stick. And then last, at the age of 30 years, at the end of rotation, we do the final felling. Okay. Now it's very simple. This is very simple. Somebody asked me, are we do any fertilization in mangrove? No, we didn't do any fertilization in mangrove forest. Okay. So objective for the final felling is just to produce the charcoal. The practice, the log will be cut into billet. Billet is more log, smaller log, about 1.6 meter long. Why 1.6 meter long? It's about our height. Why is very small, 1.6 meter. Why? Can anybody give me the reason why we cut the mangrove log only 1.6 meter long? Any idea? Or you want to answer after this? Nobody want to try? Okay, no problem. And then you remember about the buffer zone that I said to you, the buffer zone is 3 to 10 meter. So inside the buffer zone, there will be a mother tree. So our mother tree is very small amount, 7 trees per hectare. Okay, and the buffer zone also work as the erosion control, not only supply the seed, but also the erosion control. Okay, buffer prevents seedling from coming in. And buffer prevents seedling from coming in. So that means the mother tree inside the buffer zone, okay, when it's sprouting, so that means the water will push all the seed produced from buffer zone go inside the area, not go out of the area, not go into the river. And because of the tidal push, the ceiling further inside. So that means buffer can prevent ceiling from coming in, but not coming out. Eh? Okay, non-commercial species, chop and slice. We didn't use the non-commercial species. So what is the non-commercial species? For example, Bulgaria also non-commercial species, but still we have it after at the age of 30. Eh? Okay. So I would like to share to you with you this is the condition of the mangrove forest after logging. So what you see here is only small standing tree. So this small standing tree, we didn't cut, okay? We didn't cut because we are going to make it a shelter wood, okay? So this is a modification of our management system in mangrove, eh? So this is a UPM student. They go there, do their field work, okay, for our class, silviculture class. And we give them also their opinion. Eh? This is come from them, eh? From the student, to have a shelter wood system in mangrove forest. So what happened after one rotation? Eh? So the government, the forest department give to us about 10 hectares eh, for the student to do the lab work in Matang Forest. Matang Forest with UPM takes about 250 kilometers. You go by bus and then you will be overnight in Matang Mango Forest. Okay, some of the tree right, for the shelter wood, they also select. Okay, they are select to give more sunlight to the undergrowth. So this is to show to you some of the tree need to be cut down. The shelter wood eh, need to be cut down to give more sunlight for undergrowth. Okay. Emma. Okay. Did you see this guy? What this guy doing is to mark eh, the log, the mangrove log, into 1.6 meter. Okay. They didn't make it long, eh? 1.6 meter. So the question I asked to you, why they do this billet into 1.6 meter? Because of what? You can see the condition of the site. This is the logging area. So the student cannot walk on the soil. They must walk on the plank. Okay? So why they cut 1.6? Because all of this log are manually bring out from the forest. Manually, okay? Manually, that means they cut into about our height and then they put on your shoulder, their shoulder to bring manually. Eh? They use this plank to walk. Eh? They use this plank to walk. Okay? Okay, so this is to show to you how it looks like. Okay, so this is the billet. Eh? The billet 1.6 meter. So you are walking along this trail, bring this billet on your shoulder to put into this small boat. From this kind of small boat, they will bring to the logging matau eh, to the log yard. Okay. So you can imagine we didn't have any machine. We didn't have any machine. We bring this log by manually. And this is the condition after the logging. Okay. And then some of the mother tree will remain here and then give the shelter to the, okay. Okay, what the after they cut the tree, so what happened to the all this debris? They keep it like this, eh? They didn't take out, put it like this because decomposition in mangrove forest is very fast because of always wet, eh? Always wet. So decomposition is very fast. And then also by having this debris, when it's fruiting, so the seedling is be stuck here, stuck but can germinate. If there's no debris clean, so when the tide come, sometimes they wash away all the seedlings, eh? The seeds. So this is to show to you the buffer zone. Both side, this is the buffer zone. Eh? This is the buffer zone. Eh? Go to the river. Okay, the residual, the cleaning, this one, they cut everything. Why they cut, why they open more like this? Because to make water go inside and then make it decompose more faster. Okay? If not, it's take more than 10 years eh? Or maybe 20 years to be rotten. So if they do like this, it take less than 10 years eh? To be rotten. Yeah, that I said to you, it's not so much different before. Eh? Before this is early what 1920. Eh? The logging is still using the same method. We still using the small barge and eh? The small boat like this, and then the size of the tree before is very big like this. Okay, very big tree. But if you going to have a big like this, so that means you need to bring a machine. You bring the machine to the mangrove forest, it costs you a lot and also destroy the soil. Eh? So that's why our log become more at the size of the size we need to, we can cut it. Eh? If this one, it take you about 40 years, eh? The rotation. But this one is only 20 years. Eh? 20 years or to 30 years, you can cut down already. Okay, so our forest also, we can say it's reclaim the land from the sea. Yeah, reclaim the land from the sea, it slowly go to the sea and that means our land has become bigger and bigger. Eh? So planting. So every day, if you go to Matang Mango Forest, every day we have planting. We have planting every day. So our contractor, I don't know how many contractor, but the contractor are planting every day because our forest is very big, eh? 40,000 hectares for this for charcoal production alone. Okay, so objective of replanting is to get the continuous production of charcoal. The practice is very simple. Apiculata, we're using the 1.2 meter between them distance, eh? Planting distance, and meanwhile the Mucronata bakau kurap is 1.8 meter. Okay, so why apiculata must be planted closer? Why 1.2 meter compared with 1.8? 1.8 is more wider, but apiculata they need to be near 1.2 because of what? Because apiculata they're producing lots of branches compared with bakau kurap or Rhizophora Mucronata. Eh? Mucronata, they didn't produce much branches compared with apiculata. So that's why apiculata need to be planted near eh? 1.2. So that means we can reduce the production of branches. Eh? Okay, about 80% of the harvested area require enrichment planting. Why? 80% of the harvested area require enrichment planting. Because we got problem with fruiting. Okay, fruiting. And then second, because of the wildlife we have in our mangrove forest. We have lots of monkey and also we have also got problem with crab. Crab eating the mangrove seed. monkey also eating the mango seed. So sometime, if you waiting for the seed germinate naturally, maybe don't have time. Eh? After a few months, you've been eaten by the monkey. So that's why we need to bring bigger tree. 1 meter tree, for example. So 1 meter tree will be not disturbed by monkey. If you bring seed, the seed will be eaten by the monkey. Okay, so this is planting stock. We can have from the seed, from the goose, direct planting, but it's not good. Eh? And then we have widening. Widening, that means we collect the seedling that germinate in nearby forest. Okay, we collect the seedling widening from the nearby forest, and then we didn't do potting, but we direct transfer to the planting site. For example, in the morning, the contractor, sometimes they go, they collect about 200 seedling, one person. So that one person give to another group to plant. So he didn't plant, he just collect to give to another group to plant. So that mean one person collect 200, give to a group. One group is about two people. So one collector with two planter. So they can finish this 200 seedling, okay, widening, direct planting within a day. It's very small amount, 200. But this is the low cost, very low cost. Because they cannot work until morning, afternoon, because they also depend on the tidal. Air pasang, air surut. Kadang-kadang kalau masa air surut, boleh ditanam. Kalau air pasang, mana boleh masuk dalam kan? Tidal, high tide dengan low tide. When low tide, they do the planting. High tide, they cannot do planting. So that why their planting time is very limited. So we cannot ask them to plant many seedling. Each person cannot do more because of the time for time period to do the planting. Okay, then we have another one is the potted seedling. So this potted seedling mostly come from the seed, germinate it in the nursery. It stay about 5 to 6 months and then bring back to the forest. So this is quite costly because the nursery is outside of the planting area. Sometimes it stay about 30 minutes by boat to bring the seedlings from the nursery to the planting site. If by using the widening, it's more faster. Collecting 200 well-developed root system, it takes you about 2 hours. Mostly 2 hours, 200 seedling, 2 hours. And then to do planting, another 4 hours. So that means within 6 hours of low tide, you can do planting. So this is the natural regeneration. This is the seedling that I said to you. They go and then they pick up only 200 each person and then give to the two planter to do the planting. Okay. So they are using the same technique before, maybe 20 years ago and now, until now. This is direct planting, direct seeding. Okay, direct seeding. This is the seed of the mangrove. Okay, you got from the mother tree. So this, you can see the root. Okay, this is a very good seed. If you plant this one, still be eaten by the monkey. This is the problem. If you plant this kind of seed, the monkey still come and then eating. Also the crab, the crab like to eat this part. They didn't eat the root, or they eat the shoot. Okay, the to bring the widening, you can see it's quite difficult. You can bring, or maybe you can see how many, less than 10 each time. So this is the potted nursery we have nearby. And mostly our nursery is run by the village people. We ask the village people to prepare for us how many mucronata, how many apiculata. And then at the age of 5 to 6 months, the forest department will go and buy from them. Or the contractor buy from them, from the village people. And all the nursery are located inside our forest reserve. The management zone that I told you, that cannot do any plant, cannot do any logging, but it's nearby to the village people. So that forest are located, are dedicated for the nursery, yeah, because it's near to that. So this is a problem, eh? When you do the planting with the seed direct, eh? What you can see here, this is the nest of the crab. This is the nest of the crab. So that means lots of crab will be here. Okay, you can see not all tree are survived. Some of die because of the crab eating the seed. So we change to planting the potted seedling. By having the potted seedling, so the survival is more better compared with you plant direct seed seedling seeding. Eh, direct seeding. You, it's like you bring food to the crab, eh, to the monkey. Eh. Okay, this is a planted area 12 years after planting. Okay. This is in Sabah. Eh. This one is in Sabah, not in Peninsula Malaysia, in Sabah. They use a tire, car tire, eh, to use. Okay, so for the thinning, for the first year, for the first thinning, eh, for the first thinning, is for pool, eh, is for pool. It's, you can cut about 1.2 meter by using the 1.2 meter stick, eh, you meet you radius here. Eh. Second thinning, you use a longer stick, 1.8 compared with 1.2. When at the age, at the distance of 1.2, you can take out about 190 to 250 yeah, pools are thin and then become bigger. Yeah. Okay, the first year at the age of 15, yeah, 15 years old, yeah, thinning and second thinning at the age of 20 years old. So at the age of 20 years old, we're using 1.8 stick, meter stick. So at that time, we just harvest about 60 to 125 pools. Yeah. Okay, what we use for this pool? We use for charcoal. Eh? This one, because this small, we didn't use for charcoal, but mostly for the construction, eh? Piling. Eh? Piling. The first thinning for piling, mostly for piling. Second thinning, already can use for charcoal. Okay, the third thinning is actually, we can say, harvest, eh? Fine felling. Okay. So the third thinning, mostly we apply, we try, because this is try and error. And the third thinning, we have tried, but we stop because of the not enough tree, eh? Small tree. So able to regenerate easily. Okay, so should we introduce thinning number three, the third thinning? No, eh? We didn't do anymore the third thinning. So this is the way how they do the thinning. The one that I told you, the stick 1.2 meter. This is the guy holding the stick between tree, another tree. So that means within this, if any tree within this, you can cut down. Yeah, you can do the thinning. Eh? For example, like this, eh? 1.2, 1.2. So this one include in our thinning. So that means two, three are will be cut here. Meanwhile, this one we didn't do, and with this one we didn't include in the thinning. And this is using 1.2. Okay? Still using the same method. This is how many years ago? This is, I think, 30, 40 years ago. Still using the same method, using the simple one, just bring 1.2 or 1.8 meter stick, and then take the radius. Any tree within that radius, you can do the thinning. Okay? So what we have learned today, so this is the end of our class. So our what we have studied is the objective of the management. Eh? Objective of the management for the mata mangrove, we divide into four. Eh? We divide into four management. So regeneration method, mostly by natural, and then plus with the enrichment planting. Eh? Natural with enrichment planting. When we do enrichment planting, when it's less than how many percent natural? Less than 90%. So we do the enrichment planting. So our operation mostly include the thinning, felling, and also the replanting. We didn't do any branching. We didn't do any fertilizing. We just do thinning. How many thinning we do before felling? We only applied two thinning. The first thinning at the age of 15, second thinning at the age of 20 years old before we do felling at the age of 30. So when we do the replanting have been done when? Within 1 until 3 years. 1 to 3 years after felling. And so what is the importance of inventory? The importance of inventory is to know the volume. That forest, for example, is it poor or not? Because it's all according to the volume. How many tons per hectare? If less, because of mixed with Bulgaria. We mix with Bulgaria, more Bulgaria in our forest. So the forest is not, if for example, for the charcoal contractor, they want to buy a forest with less Bulgaria. They want more reservoir. With more reservoir, they can produce a good charcoal. So that is the importance of inventory. So we have the references here, but for the meantime, they are producing the soft copy of Mata Mangrove, and they are producing. Right now with me, I have a hard copy. And meanwhile, for the working plan for the Mata Mangrove Forest Reserve 2003, I think this one already they have in soft copy. Okay, with that, I think I finished my presentation for today for this class. So maybe I can open for the question. Or if you cannot or don't have, quite shy, to ask me, maybe I can leave it to you, my email address. Maybe you can have some question addressed to me through email or maybe by WhatsApp. If you want to send to me WhatsApp, my WhatsApp number, I will share with you. And in no problem if you want to ask through WhatsApp. If anyone to do study master level or PhD level next time in UPM, please come. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Agani, for lecture. And kita lanjutkan untuk diskusi kepada mahasiswa, for the student. Kalau misalkan kita sedikit untuk sharing ya, in Java, mostly we can look mangrove forest production, because in Java, the majority that there is a conservation area for mangrove. But if we want to see HPH, hak pengelolaan hutan, or mangrove forest product company, there is the bigger concession in the West Papua and Papua province. And there is produce charcoal and mangrove chips. And some company in Kalimantan or Sumatra, but there is just little. Okay. Mungkin untuk mahasiswa, untuk adik-adik mahasiswa sekalian, silakan kalau yang ingin bertanya, silakan untuk raise hand, atau mungkin bisa menanyakan secara langsung kepada Profesor Azani. Silakan kepada mahasiswa yang ingin bertanya. Silakan untuk raise hand.
Ada soalan? Silakan. Agaknya malu ya.
Malu bertanya. Mungkin sedikit harus dipancing dulu gitu, Prof. Kalau misalkan tadi saya lihat memang beberapa sistem silvikultur di apa yang dilakukan di mangrove Malaysia itu memang agaknya pasti tentunya berbeda dengan yang dilakukan di lowland. Nah, itu menjadi keunikan tertentu karena mangrove sebagai ekosistem juga memiliki sifat yang cukup fragile begitu ya, Prof. Silakan mahasiswa mungkin ingin bertanya mengenai zonasi mangrove tadi, pemanfaatannya, sistem yang digunakan, sistem silvikultur yang digunakan, whatever. Untuk pertanyaannya bisa bilingual aja ya, Pak. English or Indonesia or bahasa.
Boleh bahasa pun boleh. Lebih mudah mungkin untuk berbicara dalam bahasa. Silakan. Ya. Kalau di Malaysia ini matang mangrove forest yang berada di Perak itu adalah yang the best management system, the best mangrove management system. Kawasannya tak seluas mana, cuma 40,000 hectares. Kalau dibandingkan dengan yang ada di Sabah, kalau di Sabah dia ada hampir 300,000 hektar. Cuma masalah yang berlaku di Sabah ialah mereka ke mana mereka mahu hantarkan cakulnya. Itu yang masalah. Dia orang pernah juga in Sabah, Forestry Department of Sabah buatkan cakul, produce cakul, but to sell it is quite difficult for them. Quite difficult for them because the mangrove that we have in Manta mangrove, they already
nampaknya sedang ada gangguan sinyal. Mungkin untuk adik-adik mahasiswa, silakan untuk segera disiapkan pertanyaan-pertanyaannya supaya kita bisa lebih mendiskusikan kembali mengenai apa yang tadi sudah dikuliahkan oleh Prof. Azani. Ini ada apa pertanyaan juga dari Pak Erekso, tetapi nanti mungkin Prof. Azani nanti bisa sedikit menjelaskan. Prof. Azani, ini ada sedikit dari Pak Erekso yang
said. Hello.
Yes.
Sorry, maaf. Ada gangguan.
No problem. Ini you untuk bisa bergabung kembali, join kembali. Dari ini Pak Erekso, ya dari Pak Erekso ada pertanyaan. Interest to auto replanting method in mangrove forest because in Indonesia we have one method we call gundukan. Maybe Mr. Erekso can state about gundukan, what is that, and for sharing about gundukan. Okay, gundukan is one method about replanting method in replanting method buat mangrove. And in Indonesia, we call gundukan because there is some soil we ditumpukan begitu saja gitu, kemudian ditanam mangrove gitu. Mungkin lebih jelasnya Mr. Reso can state about the gundukan.
Okay. Kalau di Malaysia, kami tidak ada buat penambahan tanah ya. Tidak ada penambahan tanah. Apa yang dibuat biasanya kalau lebih mudah adalah pakai widening. Transfer, direct transfer daripada pokok yang sebelah sana, anak liar, terus ditanam. Itu adalah lebih baik sebenarnya. Kalau kawasan tu memang susah dapatkan anak liar, widening, so kami akan gunakan yang potted. Yang potted ini yang masalahnya ialah berat nak bawa. Macam tadi kan gambarnya kalau di sekali bawa 10 pokok saja kan. Tapi kalau pakai yang widening, yang bare root system lebih mudah untuk dibawa dan juga mudah cepat ditanam. Itu proses yang lebih berbeza sedikit untuk di mangrove kalau dibandingkan dengan di lowland forest. So lowland forest kebanyakan kita gunakan potted. Kita tidak guna yang bare rooted.
Okay, thank you very much. Ini ada permainan juga kepada Andreas, mungkin bisa bertanya langsung.
Okay, saya baca di sini ya. Andreas bertanya, apakah saat penanaman mangrove di pantai untuk letak lokasinya dapat ditanam langsung atau terdapat aturan khusus dalam lokasi penanaman? Okay, ini kalau mangrove rhizophora contoh ya. Kalau rhizophora bila ditanam masih lagi ditanam dalam line planting. Ya, yeah? Masih lagi menggunakan line planting. Dengan distance, kalau rhizophora apiculata, distance-nya adalah 1.2 meter antara pokok. Manakala untuk rhizophora macronata adalah 1.8 meter antara pokok. So, aturan ini memang dikhaskan. Katakan satu kawasan itu mau ditanam lebih, satu kawasan, satu the whole area mau ditanam dengan apiculata semua. Ataupun cuma satu spesies macronata. Kami jarang untuk digabungkan spesies tu. Kalau boleh jangan digabungkanlah. Sebab kalau gabungkan dua spesies dalam satu kawasan, kita terpaksa adakan line planting yang berbeza. Satu yang 1.2 dan satu lagi 1.8 meter. Jadi akan menyusahkan. Saya rasa itu jawapannya, Andreas Wahyu. Okey, sama-sama. Ada lagi soalan?
Izin bertanya, Pak.
Ya, silakan Rinaldi untuk unmute.
Oh ya, makasih atas waktunya. Mau nanya untuk pengelolaan mangrove di matang mangrove forest ini apa ada masalah atau tantangan yang dihadapi gitu, dan jikalau ada dalam mengatasi masalahnya itu atau ancamannya itu bagaimana gitu. Itu ya sih. Terima kasih.
Oke. Terima kasih Rinaldi. Soalannya apakah rintangan ya semasa mau tanam replanting di mata mangrove. Rintangan yang pertama adalah wildlife. Ya, kami ada masalah dengan monkey dan juga crab. Monkey dan juga crab itu adalah masalah utama. Jadi kalau dahulu kami tanam melalui kaedah direct seeding, iaitu ambil biji ditanam terus di lokasi. So itu akan menjadi masalah besar. Jadi untuk mengatasinya, kami tak akan tanam melalui seeding. Kami akan tanam bawa anak pokok yang bersaiz paling kurang 1.2 atau 1.5 meter tinggi. Ya, 1.5 meter tinggi. Bila ditanam di situ, masalah dengan monkey dan juga crab dapat diatasi. Okey. Apabila bawa anak pokok ya dalam polybag, ya, the potted seedlings. Ya. The problem with the potted seedling is in terms of heavy. Yeah, because of the heavy, you cannot bring a lot. For example, 2% can carry less than 10 seedlings. Yeah. Meanwhile, you want to plant the whole area, it's very big area. Yeah. So the big area, you need to plant lots of seedlings. Yeah. You, for example, you if you want to plant 100 seedlings, for example. So that means you need to commute many times. Yeah, you need to commute. What we do right now, we do the study. Eh? How? What is the best potting medium? Eh? The best potting medium for the mangrove seedlings, because we know that mangrove, they need mud to be in the polybag. Eh? So the mud is very heavy. Yeah, the mud is very heavy because of include the water. So what is the best potting media to make it lighter? Yeah, to make it lighter, but the seedling can survive. So what we do is the mud we mix with some fiber from the coconut husk, for example. Yeah, we mix with the coconut husk. Yeah, coconut husk mix with the mud, and then we put in the polybag. Put in the nursery. So after 4-5 months, we check the root system is very good, and then we can bring the seedling with a new potting media easily and lighter, and it's become more lighter. Then we do planting. So the problem is using that kind of new potting media will be the cost, and the cost of the potting media will be increased. So that mean before, maybe the price of one seedling is about RM5. Eh? The seedling, RM5. But using the new potting media, the cost increase another ringgit, RM1. I don't know how, RM1 how much rupiah. Eh? So increase another RM1. That means before it's only RM5. Now it's already RM6. Yeah, already RM6. So it become cost of become more higher. Okay, the third problem with planting is the time. Okay. To plant the all the seedlings must be at the low tide. At the low tide. Okay, the low tide, we need to know what is the low tide, because low tide for this week compared with next week is different. Okay. This week, next week, another week is different, eh? Because low tide is depend on the water level. Eh? Okay, the time. So that means you need to take care about when you can start planting as fast as soon when the low tide is very low. So that means sometimes when the high tide, so the contractor just send all the seedling to the nearby forest, okay, to put to the nearby forest. And then at the when once the low tide start, okay, when the low light start, they can do the planting as fast as they can. So that mean one day you cannot plant a lot of tree because of the time period of low tide is very short. Eh? So that is the most problem or task that we dealing when you do the planting. In terms of planting stock. Planting stock is enough. Planting stock is enough. We don't have any problem with the planting stock. We also now producing tissue culture for the rhizophora. So that means if you need a lot, maybe tissue culture is best. No need to wait from the seed from the tree. So we use the tissue culture. Okay, so there's a question come from Anggita Putri.
Maybe Anggita ingin menyampaikan secara langsung. Mungkin bagaimana menjelaskan dulu. Silakan Anggita.
Baik Pak, terima kasih atas waktunya. Saya Anggita izin bertanya kepada Pak Azani mengenai dalam penanaman mangrove. Dalam penanaman mangrove di pantai, apakah ada strategi khusus agar program penanaman tersebut berhasil? Karena waktu itu saya pernah mengikuti program penanaman mangrove, namun gagal dan program tersebut tidak berjalan lagi. Mungkin apakah ada kemungkinan dari salah strategi penanaman atau karena kondisi bibit yang kurang baik atau karena faktor lain ya Pak? Terima kasih.
Ya, oke. Soalan ini pun menarik juga ya. Kenapa penanaman mangrove gagal ya? Antara yang hasil daripada kajian yang dijalankan ya di UPM, saya bersama dengan beberapa penyelidik daripada Jepun ya, daripada Japan, we study about why when you do the planting ya, when you do the planting of rhizophora. Okay, we have a planting trial in one of the beach in Kedah. Kedah is more northern part of Perak, about another 50 kilometers from Perak, from the Matang mangrove forest, not so far. So the problem is when we do planting, after 1 year, we found lots of our seedling die. Totally, until now, there's no trees that survive in our plot. We can say 100% already died. Because of what? Because of the current, the wave from the sea. When you do the planting, sometimes we know that previously, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, there's a mangrove over there. We check the history, background of the area. 20 or 30 years ago, there's a lot of mangrove. But mangrove disappeared over there because of human come, the car, the village people take the tree, everything. But also because of the changes of the current, the ocean current. So mangrove, rhizophora, for example, they can survive if there's enough mud flat. They have rhizophora, need mud flat to survive. But the problem that occur in Kedah is a little bit different because of the current move all the mud and then bring the sand. You understand that? The current, the ocean current, move all the mud and change with the sand. With the sand. So the sand accumulate over there. So that means the planting site is not already suitable for the rhizophora, because rhizophora need the mud flat, not the sandy area. So this is one of why the planting is failed, because of the current move the mud flat replaced with the sand. Okay. Other than that, if the condition still mud flat, but still problem with the survival, maybe because of the seedlings, it's not enough in terms of the root development, it's not enough. The root development not enough, that means the tree is still young. We know that based from our experience, at least 5 to 6 months, we need to raise the seedling in the nursery. The seedling in the nursery, 5 to 6 months. After 5 to 6 months, you can have a good quality of mangrove seedling. Eh? We have the root is very good, eh? So you can plant it. If you plant less than 5 months in the nursery, for example, 3 months, eh? The root system is not developed well yet. Eh? The root system is not developed enough in the poly bag. So when you do planting, when you open the poly bag, the soil broken and then it's also broke or damaged the root system. When you plant a seedling with a damaged root system, that means the mortality will be high. Eh? You disturb the root system. Eh? So that's why some of the condition, the failure of the project because of the handling, eh? The handling of the seedling. And the first is the current, second is the handling of the seedling. I think that's the factors that affect your planting, eh? Is fail now. Okay, thank you, Anjita.
Oke, terima kasih banyak untuk Anggita atas pertanyaannya. Ada lagi? Halo? Lagi? Sedikit bercerita tadi mengenai program gitu ya Prof. Misalkan di Indonesia itu kan juga cukup banyak begitu ya mengenai program-program reforestasi, rehabilitasi kawasan mangrove begitu ya. Rehabilitasi mangrove gitu itu sangat sudah lumayan sangat banyak sekali sekarang-sekarang. Tetapi memang tantangannya tadi yang ditanyakan oleh Anggita memang apa kegagalan-kegagalan dalam program gitu. Dan ya kalau secara teknis memang yang saya perhatikan memang biasanya ada tiga macam karena persoalan memang binatang entah itu binatang liar ataupun peliharaan, kemudian mengenai tadi crabs terus dan juga manusia, satu lagi manusia. Kadang-kadang kita sudah melakukan banyak program, tetapi masyarakat tidak mau untuk ditanami mangrove, dicabut-cabut gitu. Memang itu menjadi tantangan tersendiri, salah satunya memang manusia. Nah, sebagai ini apa sharing dengan mahasiswa juga, begitu Prof. Apa untuk di Malai itu, apakah sekiranya ada program atau mungkin yang diinisiasi oleh perguruan tinggi atau mungkin government yang tujuannya memang untuk rehabilitasi mangrove. Tujuannya memang untuk rehabilitasi mangrove. Karena kita tahu sendiri belakangan memang kita sedang berhadapan dengan persoalan iklim yang mana tentunya salah satunya berhubungan dengan mangrove. Mungkin begitu Prof, sebagai pemantik untuk mahasiswa. Oke, Prof Azani mungkin sudah terlempar kembali. Kembali persoalan dengan sinyal. Jangan lupa isi absennya ya. Itu Pak Rifki sudah mempersiapkan absen pagi dan nanti sebelum ditutup juga ada absen lagi gitu ya. Jadi absennya dua kali seperti kemarin absen dua kali karena kebutuhan untuk mata kuliah silvikultur berkelanjutan tutornya itu kan nanti akan ada dua kali pertemuan. Oke. Prof Azani sudah kembali bergabung. Have you join? Not yet. Oke. Okay. Jangan lupa untuk diisi ya absennya. untuk hujan pagi. Oke, kita menunggu kembali Bapak Zani. Mungkin untuk adik-adik mahasiswa, silakan disiapkan lagi satu pertanyaan lagi aja. Satu pertanyaan lagi untuk Prof. Azani bisa menjelaskan mengenai mangrove di Malaysia. Bagaimana sistem silvikulturnya? Tadi kan lebih banyak ke rehabilitasi, penanaman, dan coba kita gali lebih lanjut mengenai sistem silvikultur, bagaimana pemanfaatannya, sistem penebangan yang digunakan, terus kemudian sistem pemanenan. Tadi kan sudah disampaikan dalam kuliahnya tadi sudah disampaikan. Kalau misalkan ada pertanyaan-pertanyaan, misalkan apakah ada integrasi antara hutan dengan pabriknya, gitu. Integrasi hutan dengan pabriknya, yang mana kalau misalkan kita berbicara di Indonesia ada beberapa perusahaan-perusahaan yang memang dia pabriknya itu on-site, sehingga ketika keluar dari hutan itu sudah menjadi bahan baku yang siap untuk digunakan oleh user atau penggunanya. Kalau tadi Prof. Alias itu berbicara mengenai charcoal, atau mungkin chips gitu ya, yang mana mangrove itu sangat baik, bagus sekali bahan-bahannya itu. Dan kalau misalkan boleh sharing, itu yang uang yang kalian gunakan itu kertasnya itu salah satunya dari mangrove, untuk dolar ya, tapi ya bukan rupiah. Rupiah ada lagi. Untuk dolar itu kertasnya itu dari mangrove juga. Karena kayunya sangat kuat sekali. Oke, baik. Prof. Azani sudah join kembali?
Iya. Okay. Kembali. Tapi dengan cuaca ini, quite heavy wind.
Baik. Mungkin buat untuk mahasiswa silakan, kalau ada pertanyaan lagi, satu atau dua lagi mungkin bisa. Ya kan? Ya, tadi satu atau dua lagi mungkin. Informasinya minta pelatihnya. Siapa ya? Silakan. Tasya barangkali. Ayo pindah. Zainuddin mungkin. Ya. Mungkin tadi sedikit ini Prof, ada yang ingin saya tanyakan tadi, menarik. Bagaimana kalau misalkan di Malaysia, apakah memang dari government gitu ada capaian-capaian tertentu untuk rehabilitasi dan restorasi mangrove di Malaysia gitu dari government? Tentunya government yang melakukan, entah nanti inisiatornya itu dari kampus ataupun memang dari government sendiri. Mungkin begitu, Prof.
Okay, di Malaysia, mangrove telah menjadi salah satu daripada hutan yang diberi sepenuh perhatian, sepenuh perhatian oleh government, because of since 2004, after the big tsunami in Aceh, so our government recognized as all the mangrove forests along the coastal need to do something to protect them. So whenever the forest, mangrove forest have been cut, so you need to do replanting. So if the area, for example, the area in Matang mangrove forest is for production. So when you cut down, the contractor cut down by the tree, they need to pay to the government the cost to do replanting. They need to pay the cost to do replanting. So the cost is not 100% paid by the government, by the contractor, but they just pay for the cost of seedlings, eh? The cost of seedling. So that means around 1/5 of the cost of replanting will be paid by the contractor. Eh? Meanwhile, since 2004 or so, we have a committee, a national committee to take care about our mangrove forest. So every year we have a planting program. Eh? This planting program not only paid by the government, sponsored by the government, but it's also involved with many company, big company, either our local company or international company to do the planting. Eh? So they do the planting, bear their cost, everything. So the government, we give to them exemption into tax, tax exemption. Eh? So until now, for example, this year we have a program we call program to plant 100 million trees. Eh? Program 100 million. Eh? The program is program 100 million trees. Eh? It means that we are going to plant 100 million trees, not only in mangrove, but the whole area in Malaysia, eh? Including Sabah and Sarawak, 100 million trees. Not only the mangrove, but not only the forest, but also everywhere. But everywhere. So by having this kind of program, so government open to more company, and to open to more company, if they do contribution, for example, sponsor the planting ceremony, buying the seedlings for the local people, give to the government to plant it. So all these companies will get the tax exemption. Eh? So in terms of who's doing planting, so it's volunteer. Eh? Volunteer. For example, next month in UPM, we are going to have a planting ceremony sponsored by one of the electric company. The electric company. So they are going to sponsor us for 5 years. Eh? For 5 years, it costs about $1 million ringgit for 5 years. So that means 200,000 ringgit a year. So what tree to be planted is come to us, eh? Back to UPM, where to plant. For this year, because of the pandemic, we are concentrate to plant inside the urban area. Yeah, inside the urban area. We also have planning, eh? Because of mangrove, we are planning 2023. Eh? The year 2023, we are planning to do the mangrove planting. Another 2 years. Eh? Because to run mangrove planting, you need to have a lot of preparation, especially prepare the seedlings. Eh? The seedlings. Eh? Second, you need to prepare the planting site. When you do the planting site, all the mangrove, you must remember, are located in the tidal wave. Yeah, low and high tide, everything. So that means you cannot plant every day, but you need to do study when there is the low tide and when is the high tide. So how to commute the person to the planting site, everything. So that's why to do the planting at the mangrove forest, you need to plan very well. And so that means you need to plan early. For me, it's take 1 year is better than you plan for 3 months. Eh? You take 1 year so you can prepare a lot. So the seedlings, the health of the seedling, the way to go inside, everything. So not only mangrove have been planted by people, local people or volunteer, but also other place. Eh? Pit swarm also. Pak Arezzo mungkin satu hari nanti saya akan bagi lagi lecture sebab saya memang tidak kesempatan untuk menyampaikan syarahan berkaitan dengan peat swarm. Dan saya kalau diberi masa lagi, saya juga akan berkongsi bersama restoration program yang pernah dijalankan di Malaysia pada semua jenis hutan. Bukan only mangrove, bukan only hydrocarp, dan ini termasuk yang terbaru yang saya selesaikan adalah di mountain forest. Ya, di mountain forest. Dan di sini juga sebenarnya datangnya silviculture system, yang mana silviculture system dah diadaptasi untuk lowland forest, hill eucalyptus forest, mangrove forest. Tapi belum ada lagi silviculture treatment untuk mountain forest. Ya, mountain forest tidak ada sampai sekarang di Malaysia, kami belum ada lagi silviculture system yang proper for the mountain forest. Ya, so saya bersama dengan team research team di UPM ini sekarang berusaha untuk menyediakan satu management plan untuk mountain forest. Restoration of mountain forest, but we don't have silviculture treatment yet. So we don't have any experience do the silviculture treatment at the mountain forest. So this is come the way learn what we have done in lowland, here to talk up, and then we're going to adapt to the mountain forest. Because planting in mountain forest, we're using a different species. We cannot bring the species from hill eucalyptus, we cannot bring species from lowland forest to be planted on the mountain forest. Yeah, mountain forest, the weather is quite different between lowland and hill. Mountain forest, minimum temperature in Malaysia can go until around 7 to 8 degrees Celsius, and daytime can go until 30. So quite big range, eh? In the afternoon, 30. At night, they can go 10 degrees. Eh? So you need to get a special species that come from mountain forest. So when you do this, I explain this, I have planned this mountain forest 2016. Okay, 2016 until now, the tree is very big, but we don't have a proper silviculture treatment yet. Okay. For mangrove, I think we don't have any problem, the silviculture treatment, or we can say the management plan is very good already. We don't have any problem except some modification on to make it faster. Eh? For example, we are looking how to make the rhizophora grow more faster. Because we cannot put fertilizer in mangrove forest. We cannot put fertilizer in mangrove forest. So that means all the planted mangrove for species are depend on the fertility of the soil. If the soil is not fertile, so that means they will go slow. But we cannot do any fertilization. So how to fertilize mangrove forest? This is one of the challenge to us. Eh? Maybe we need to do some inoculation to the tree. Eh? Put direct fertilizer inside the tree. I don't know. Maybe we can do research together to get how to fertilize the seedling or the mangrove. Lowland, you can put fertilizer. Put fertilizer, shorten the period of the rotation. Eh? If mangrove is 30 years without fertilization, if with fertilization, maybe we can go 20 years. But how to fertilize the mangrove forest? That is the problem. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Tani. Maybe kita bisa ini apa state sedikit untuk mahasiswa bagaimana? Apa adik-adik mahasiswa masih ada pertanyaan lagi yang ingin didiskusikan? Oke, kalau misalkan sudah tidak ada, mungkin kita sampaikan ke Pak Rekso untuk state sedikit. Pak Rekso? Halo, Pak Rekso. Oke.
Bentar.
Oke. Baik.
Halo. Suara saya kedengaran, Pak
Rekso? Ya, kedengar, Pak Rekso. silakan untuk sedikit state, Exo, mengenai program atau mata kuliah.
Terima kasih, Prof. Azani. Halo.
Ya, terdengar, Pak.
Terima kasih, Pak Azani. Saya senang sekali. I am happy because you can share your experience, and this is a new experience to me. And then maybe I will go to visit Malaysia to see how to manage a mangrove area. This is a unique area. It is unique area because of Pagil, right? I hope my students can see how to manage another area without same with the lowland. Artinya sepertinya ada perbedaan, karena saya belum, we don't see in Indonesia how to manage a mangrove area. Jadi ini sesuatu yang baru. Mungkin nanti satu ketika when I go to visit Malaysia, you can see how to manage area mangrove, dan mata kuliah silvicultur harapan saya juga bisa bermanfaat ke my student, dan mereka mengerti, to understand how to manage suatu area dengan another technique. Setelah ini saya ataupun teman-teman saya yang dari Brawijaya dan anak-anak student ini bisa berkunjung langsung untuk melihat bagaimana sistem pengelolaan atau forest management di Malaysia. Karena tadi di Jawa itu mungkin kurang untuk yang forest production in mangrove. Jadi seperti yang disampaikan Pak Asif, itu banyak di Papua tadi itu. Jadi hanya untuk di natural forest, protection forest. Jadi tidak dimanfaatkan untuk charcoal tadi. Jadi sesuatu yang bagus untuk kita, karena memang pengalaman experience kita di mangrove masih sedikit, dan ini sesuatu yang bagus untuk diteliti atau di riset untuk dikembangkan nanti di Brawijaya itu seperti apa. Oke, terima kasih Pak Azani dengan segala materi yang disampaikan. I am happy and I hope my student can learn anything from you. Tidak hanya hari ini, mungkin nanti mereka akan mengirimkan email, atau mungkin mereka bisa jadi student exchange atau student master. UPM, mungkin Pak Asif juga bisa untuk kuliah di UPM, PhD student pelaksana. Memohon maaf kalau ada yang tidak sesuai, Pak. Harapannya selain hari ini atau selain waktu ini, kita bisa komunikasi lagi via email atau via WhatsApp. Mungkin itu, Pak, yang bisa saya sampaikan, dan ini sesuatu yang baru, dan saya minta adik-adik untuk merekam semua. Makanya saya minta untuk meresum apa yang disampaikan oleh Pak Azani, karena ini bisa jadi tidak disampaikan di kuliah di Brawijaya, Pak. Jadi sesuatu materi yang baru untuk kita di Brawijaya. Terima kasih, Pak Azani. Terima kasih, Pak Asif. Terima kasih juga adik-adik sekalian. Mungkin ada closing statement untuk adik-adik, Pak, yang atau sudah tadi Pak Asif disampaikan?
Untuk closingnya belum, Pak.
Oh, oke. Okay. Jadi harapan saya itu, Pak, mudah-mudahan kerjasama kita tidak hanya di program 3-in-1, mungkin nanti ada program yang lain yang bisa kita kerjasamakan, mungkin riset ataupun studi action atau yang lainnya. Kalau saya tertarik, karena saya memang hobi jalan-jalan ke hutan. Oke, okay, thank you Pak Azani. Terima kasih Pak Asif. Saya persilakan kembali untuk memimpin kegiatannya.
Baik, terima kasih banyak Pak Rexo untuk berbagai macam informasinya, mulai dari bagaimana program kuliahnya dan juga harapan-harapan kedepannya. Harapan-harapan kedepannya tentu tidak hanya sampai sini, dan bisa dilanjutkan. Dan mungkin ada closing statement dari Bapak Zani, mungkin dipersilakan untuk closing statement-nya.
Oke, terima kasih kerana menjemput saya to be with you to talk about the civil culture treatment. Civil culture treatment that been used in Malaysia. InsyaAllah, if we have more time together, maybe I can give some share with you the experience, the pit swamp civil culture management system, and also to share with you about the restoration, forest restoration project that have been done in Malaysia. Personally, I'm involved the restoration of ecosystem since 1990 in Sarawak. After I'm graduate my undergraduate in 1990 from UPM, I went to Sarawak to do the rehabilitation project between Malaysia and Japan. So from then, I learned lots about the way how to plant, to take care the seedlings, to care the tree until the tree been harvest. So silviculture is one of my main topic for me. So I would like to thanks to especially to Pak Arezzo because invite me to be with all of you to share my experience and also Malaysian experience in manage the forest, especially the lowland deep trunk forest, hill deep trunk forest, and also for today we share with together with you the mangrove forest. So I would like to invite all of you, especially all the students, to come to Malaysia. Either maybe we can do under exchange student program, or maybe you can come to UPM for further study, master or PhD level, or maybe for Pak Ashif and also Pak Reso to come to Malaysia to do a joint research project, to join the research project with UPM. Not only with me, but with other lecturers. I also have the collaboration with Japanese. Maybe we can come together. We do the silviculture research or on restoration or also under the vegetation study. So I'd like to invite all to be here, inshallah, after this pandemic. Maybe next year you start coming. Maybe inshallah next year, I think we can cross already. Go to Indonesia, Indonesia can come to Malaysia. We already stuck for 2 years because of the pandemic. Now the pandemic is getting better, everybody got vaccine, and we know that vaccine is very important. We are going to open our university next month, middle of next month. We're going to start the student, we coming back to the campus middle of next month. maybe they come back to the campus, but not direct doing the face-to-face, but still online. But at the same time, slowly, we're going to have the lab work. The class will be online, but the lab work will start in the lab. We can go to the forest to do the survey, everything with strict the standard operation, her procedure according to the COVID-19. So very strict. InsyaAllah, maybe one day. And for your information, our student right now, UPM student, went to Korea for the last 6 months ago. They went to Korea 6 months ago after got fully vaccinated, 2 doses. They go to Korea to study about the forest plantation. Forest plantation there, and also the vegetation study. So I think Malaysia also going to follow that kind of way, invite all the students, make sure the student got fully vaccinated, maybe together with booster, I don't know, the third vaccinated, come to Malaysia. We do the short term, maybe 6 months only, not 1 year, 6 months stay in Malaysia. After that, going to invite again. Please, 6 months when you are doing undergraduate. Okay, after finish undergraduate, you can come back for master lah. Yeah, for master. For within 6 months, come to Malaysia, study what is the your future topic that you're going to go for master level. Okay, that's all from me, Pak RSO, and also to others. I'm very happy to have a lecture with all of you. Thank you again.
Okay. Thank you very much, Prof. Azami, for your closing statement. And for the student, jangan lupa untuk isi absensinya. Nah, karena absensinya ada dua kali, untuk kuliah dan juga untuk tutorial. Okay, thank you very much for Prof. Azani for the lecture. Terima kasih banyak juga untuk Pak Rekso selaku panitia penyelenggara dan juga untuk para mahasiswa. Terima kasih banyak. Pada kesempatan kali ini mungkin kita akhiri. Mungkin demikian yang bisa kami sampaikan. Mohon maaf atas segala kekurangan. Baik, terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi.
Terima kasih banyak Prof. Azani.
Ya,
mudah-mudahan ke depan bisa berkunjung ke Malaysia, bisa jumpa langsung dan juga bisa belajar langsung dengan Prof. Azani. Terima kasih.